In this video, we're going to discuss latent knowledge estimation, which is a type of analysis that's been used in the field of educational data mining. And more specifically, we're going to give an example of Bayesian knowledge tracing, which is one type of latent knowledge estimation. A lot of research in educational data mining has been done on this problem of evaluating whether a student knows or doesn't know something. And this problem is often called latent knowledge estimation or knowledge inference. So why do we call it latent knowledge estimation? Well, the reason why we use the word latent is because we have no way of actually directly observing whether a student knows something or not. We can't really, well, go and look at the student's brain to see if they have the right connection. And we can't really ask the student either, because although some students are going to be really good at telling us what they do know and don't know, some other student might think that they know something, but they don't actually, or they might not realize that they know something when they do know. And so we need to assess or estimate something that cannot be observed, and that's why we call it latent. So we can't observe the knowledge itself, but what we can observe is whether the student is able to apply a knowledge component in a specific context. And this will give us indirect information about whether or not the student knows this knowledge component. But it's sometimes possible for a student to succeed without knowing something, right? So it's possible that the student will just simply be lucky and guess the correct answer, or it's possible that the student will use some other knowledge component that we did not account for to solve the problem. It's also possible for a student to fail at applying a knowledge component, even if they know it. So it's possible that they will make a minor or careless mistake that we also sometimes call slip. Or it's possible that they will fail at realizing that this knowledge component is relevant in the current context, and so they won't apply it. It doesn't mean that they don't know it. And so because of that, a single observation of success and failure gives us incomplete information about the student's knowledge. So rather, what we can do is use the history of all successes and failure in the past to give us more information about whether the student knows something or doesn't know something. So for example, if we're given a series of attempts at applying a specific knowledge component, with each attempt can either be a success or a failure, then what can we infer about the student's knowledge? So if we start here with a sequence of 9 attempts at applying a knowledge component, right? We can look at that and see, well, in that specific example, the student succeeded every time they tried to attempt the knowledge component. So what we can conclude is that it's very likely that the student knows this knowledge component. Now, similarly, if the student makes one mistake out of those 9 attempts, then it's still very likely that they know the knowledge component. On the other hand, we can have the opposite, where someone out of 9 attempts fails 9 times. And so what we'll say is that it's very likely that they don't know the knowledge component. Similarly, if they have 1 success out of those 9 attempts, it's still very, very likely that they don't know the knowledge component. But then we can also have a little bit more complex patterns of successes and failure. For example, the student might start with 5 failures, and then go on to succeed 4 times in a row. And so what that indicates is that it's very likely that at first, the student did not master the knowledge component, but then after a few attempts, they finally learned it, and then they were able to succeed. But again, this is fairly easy to interpret, but what happens when we have more of a mix of failure and successes? So in this example, there's still more successes than there are failures, but it's not very clear why exactly the student is failing. So we'll say that it's somewhat likely that the student knows the knowledge component, but we're not completely sure. And then it can become even more confusing if you have something where the student alternate between successes and failure. What does that mean? Right? So it's not, as I've shown with those examples, it's not always obvious whether the student knows something or doesn't know it. And it's not always obvious when exactly the student learned that knowledge component. So what we want to do with latent knowledge estimation is we want to build a model that's going to be able to give us an idea what the probability is that the student will know a knowledge component or not. And this probability is going to be computed using past successes and failures as evidence of knowledge. So why do we want to do that? Why is it useful? Well, in the educational context, what we want to do mostly is we want to try to improve the student knowledge. It's an important goal. So if we can measure the knowledge of the student while they're engaging in the learning activities, then that will allow us to improve instruction. We can inform instructors about the current state of the student's knowledge, or we could make automated decisions that try to optimize what learning activity should we propose to the student next, knowing what their knowledge is right now, and then we can evaluate what's their chance of success in different problems. We can decide which problem to give them. And so one way to do that is to use algorithms we call knowledge tracing. That refers to model that traces the student's successes and failure against a model that's designed to estimate the student's knowledge. And so knowledge tracing has been mostly developed in the context of intelligent tutoring systems, although it's been applied since to different types of learning environments. The most well-known knowledge tracing model is called Bayesian knowledge tracing, and this is the one we're going to be talking about today. So in Bayesian knowledge tracing, it's not designed to assess knowledge for broad knowledge components such as additions. Rather, it's designed to assess knowledge of very well-defined fine-grained skills, for example, the addition of two-digit numbers with no carry. And so knowledge tracing has a couple of very strong assumptions that it makes on what the skills are. So for example, a skill is going to be atomic and is either going to be known or not known. So it's not possible to have a skill that is partially known in Bayesian knowledge tracing. And again, and also it's possible for the student to learn the skill every time they have to apply it. And once the skill is known, the student can forget it. So this is probably not true. When students learn something, they can in fact forget it. But in the context of Bayesian knowledge tracing, to simplify the model, we assume that there is no forgetting. So what exactly does a Bayesian knowledge tracing model look like? Well, first of all, Bayesian knowledge tracing is a two states model. It has two states that are latent. Either the student has learned the skill or the student has not learned the skill. There's only two possibilities. Now, every time the student has to practice applying the skill, then there is a chance that the student will learn the skill, which means that they will transition from not learned state to learned state. And we say that there is a probability P of T that the student is going to make that transition. Now, every practice opportunity, the student can either apply the skill correctly or incorrectly. And because there are two states, not learn and learn, then there's different reasons why a student might incorrectly apply the skill or correctly apply the skill. So first, if we look at a student that we would say is in the not learn state, there's two possibilities. First of all, the student could still get the correct answer, and this will happen when they guess what the answer should be. So even though they don't know how to apply the skill, they still succeed. So we're going to say that there's a probability P of G that the student is going to be able to guess even if they don't know the skill, and they'll get the correct answer. Now, the other outcome is that the student is getting the incorrect answer, which is probably the expected outcome if the student doesn't know the skill. And so we're going to say there's a probability 1 minus P of guess that the student will get the incorrect answer if they don't know the skill. Now, that's if they don't know the skill. If they know the skill, there's the same thing. We can either succeed at applying the skill or fail at applying the skill. So first of all, we're going to look at when the student fails to apply the skill, even though they know it. So this is mostly caused by careless mistake that we call slip. So we're going to say that in this model, there's a probability P of S that the student will slip and incorrectly apply the skill, even if they are in the learned state. And then that means that in order to correctly apply the skill when the student is in the learned state, they need to not slip. So there's a probability 1 minus P of S that the student is going to be able to correctly apply the skill if they know the skill. Right? So in this model, there's two states and there's observation of successes and failure. So the states themselves, we can never observe them, we can only infer whether the student is in that state or not based on the observation that we make. So in addition, there's a last element to the Bayesian knowledge tracing model. It's that before even the student starts practicing the skill, it's possible that they already know it. And so we're going to say that there's a probability L0 that the student has learned the skill at the practice opportunity 0, which is before they even start applying it. So as a quick summary of Bayesian knowledge tracing, each Bayesian knowledge tracing model is defined by a set of 4 parameters. 2 of those are what we call learning parameters. So L0, which is the probability that the skill is known before the student starts practicing it, and T, which is the probability that the student will be able to transition from the not learned state to the learned state. There's also 2 performance operator parameters. The first one is G. It's the probability that the student is going to be able to guess what the answer should be even when they don't know the skill. And there's the probability S, which is the probability that the student will slip and get the incorrect answer on the skill even though they know it. So in order to build a Bayesian knowledge tracing model, what we need to do is we need to find the best value for each of those 4 parameters. And how this is done is we're going to go and collect data about student trying to apply that skill in the learning environment. And then we're going to use the computer to look at the different possibility for those 4 parameters and find the ones that better predict actual successes and failure of those students in the data that we collected. Now, once we've trained that model, once we've built that model, then we can apply it to new students and we can apply it to try to compute the probability that the student knows a skill after each practice opportunity, which allows us to track the student's knowledge as they're using the learning environment. And we can also use it to try to compute how likely it is that the student will succeed at applying the skill in a future practice opportunity. And so in order to compute those probability, we can use the following equations that I've shown here. I'm not going to go into details about those equations, but if you are interested in them, then you can pause the video, look at them, or you can look at papers on Bayesian knowledge tracing. So what I'm going to be doing now is I'm going to give you an example of how we can apply a Bayesian knowledge tracing model. So in this example, we have a Bayesian knowledge tracing model that's defined by 4 parameters. The first one is L0, which is there's 40% chance that the student knows the skill before the first practice opportunity. Then there's T, which is 10% chance that the student is going to learn the skill every time they have to apply it. There's S, which is there's 30% chance that the student will slip and incorrectly apply the skill even if they know it. And then there's G, which is 20% chance that the student will guess the correct answer even if they don't know the skill. So if we want to apply the model, the first thing we're going to do is for the first practice opportunity, we're going to say, well, L0 is 40%, so there's 30% chance that the student already knows the skill before we know anything about how the student is doing in the learning environment. Then we can look at the outcome of this first practice opportunity and see that the student actually failed at applying the skill. So using that information as evidence of knowledge, we can adjust our estimate of the student's knowledge and say, well, now we're going to say that there's 28% chance that the student knows this skill because they only tried to apply it once and they failed. Now for the second practice opportunity, what we're going to do is we're going to take that 28% chance and we're going to say, okay, before the second practice opportunity, we think that there's 28% chance that the student knows this skill. And then we're going to look at, okay, did the student actually succeed? Yes, they did. So because the student succeeded, that's going to give us information about whether the student knows the skill or not. So again, we're going to adapt our probability, and now we're going to say, well, we think that there's about 62% chance that the student actually knows the skill now because they've shown us that they were able to apply it. For the third practice opportunity, we're going to say we start at 62% chance that the student actually knows the skill. And what we observe is that the student, in fact, was able to successfully apply the skill, which means that it's less likely that they're just guessing because they succeeded twice in a row, which means that now we're going to say we think that the student has about 86.5% chance that they know the skill. And then finally, for the fourth practice opportunity, we're going to start with this 86.5% chance, and then we're going to look at the outcome and say, well, now the student failed to apply the skill. What does that mean? So because the student failed to apply the skill, we're going to adjust our probability and say, well, maybe 86% was a little bit too high, so we're going to decrease to 0.73%, because it's still possible that the student knows the skill because they might have slipped. There's a 30% chance that they slip. So it decreases a little bit, but not by too much. And so this gives you kind of the very broad example of how we can apply a Bayesian knowledge tracing model and get an estimate of whether or not the student knows a skill. And just to conclude quickly, in this video, what we did is we looked at the concept of latent knowledge estimation. We looked at what it is, and we've seen that it can be useful in order to select, for example, optimal problem that a student should attempt next. We can also use it to provide teachers with an overview of the student's knowledge, for example. And we also looked at the classical Bayesian knowledge tracing model that can be used to estimate student knowledge. Even though classical Bayesian knowledge tracing model is still very much used in the literature, it's not the only model that can be used. There are more advanced Bayesian knowledge tracing models that try to account for some of the limitation. There's performance factor analysis, there's item response theory. I'm not gonna talk about those approaches in this video, but if you're interested in latent knowledge estimation, I invite you to find papers and read about those.